Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Kyle Stenger. I'm the outreach director at the Princeton Garden Theater. And the Garden Theater I've been at for 8 years, and you know, it's just like a wonderful place to be. I don't know if anyone on this call like comes there or any other Renew theaters or the Gettysburg Theater, but thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for patronizing our cinemas. One thing I wanted to note about this Keep Focus series is that it's funded by the VESTA Fund, which is the reason why we're able to host these discussions for free. Our upcoming events for Deep Focus on June 20th, we are doing Wizard of Oz, which will also be led by our speaker tonight, Alan Amtzis. And that is actually part of our Flaming Classics series. So a series focusing on queer cinema. On July 11th, we are also showing, discussing The Matrix, also part of the Flaming Classics series. That one will be playing in cinemas at the Ambler and the Garden Theater on July 6th. You can obviously stream any of these movies if you don't feel comfortable coming out to the theater, if you miss the showing at the theaters. And then on July 25th, we are doing The Blues Brothers, which plays June 21st at the Ambler and Garden and June 28th at the County Theater. So today we are doing Alfred Hitchcock's North by Northwest. And speaking here tonight is Alan Amtzis. He is the director of the Masters of Education Instruction Program at the College of New Jersey, where he also teaches a course called Terms of EnQueerMent, a History of LGBTQ Film and Media. He holds a master's degree in film studies from Columbia University, where he wrote his thesis on Max Ophuls' The Earrings of Madame D, which is a truly lovely film, by the way. His lifelong love of movies began at age 5, when he saw his first movie in the theater, and get this, Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho. Prior to becoming an educator, he worked as a script reader and a casting director for films, music videos, and commercials, and he appeared briefly as a featured extra in the costume party scene in Jonathan Demme's 1993 Philadelphia as the Pope. But don't blink or you miss his moments. He is a proud member of the County Theater and is thrilled to be part of Renew Theater's Deep Focus series. Thank you so much, Alan, for doing this. Before I turn it over to you, I just want to remind people to remain on mute unless they are currently speaking. And feel free to use the chat feature if you like have anything to say or add, but don't want to speak out loud. And you don't have to keep your camera on. If you don't feel comfortable with that, feel free to turn your camera off. That is all I have here tonight. Thank you, Alan, and enjoy tonight's discussion, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Kyle. Thank you. And thank you, everyone, for showing up. It's really wonderful to see some familiar names and faces and to be part of this again. I love the County Theater and I love these Deep Focus sessions, whether I'm hosting or just an audience member. So thank you. And I'm really excited about the opportunity to talk with all of you about one of Alfred Hitchcock's most entertaining movies. I've done a lot of research. There's a lot written about Alfred Hitchcock in general and about this movie in particular, which surprised and delighted me. So I'm going to be going in and out of PowerPoint. I hope I'll do it elegantly and smoothly, but there may be a few moments where I say, just a moment. Try not to be impatient. And I'll definitely be looking sort of sideways to see some of my notes. So I hope that won't be distracting. I am actually, to be honest, very tempted to just throw away my presentation and my notes and just go all around the Zoom room and have everyone say, my favorite scene is whatever, crop duster, Mount Rushmore, the train, the auction, the drunk driving, the UN. And I bet we could go around without ever repeating a scene. The movie is really that delightful, and it's made up of all these set pieces. And you'll hear a little more about that later. But in truth, the way this movie was structured was through conversations with Alfred Hitchcock and his screenwriter, Ernest Lehman. Ernest Lehman said once in an interview that he wanted to create the most Hitchcockian of Hitchcock movies ever. And how he did that was he and Hitch had a Hitch and I, we're old friends. He and Alfred Hitchcock had a series of conversations about all the scenes that Alfred Hitchcock had always imagined in one movie or another, but never made it onto the screen. And so they used some of those to structure this crazy travel across America. So I'm going to assume that everyone has seen the film at least once. I certainly hope you have. But if you haven't, here's a spoiler alert. It ends happily. Not at first, it doesn't. There are several moments where you may be kind of convinced that it's going to end in tragedy, but no one kills Cary Grant. It just doesn't happen. In fact, I'm not sure he ever dies in a movie, except for maybe the bishop's wife and Topper, in which he's already dead. He plays a ghost. But I don't think any harm ever comes to him in any movie. I couldn't think of one. So in this movie, and I'm going to quote here from Oscar Wilde in The Importance of Being Earnest, the good end happily and the bad end unhappily, for that is what fiction means. So this evening is going to be part celebration and part analysis. The celebration is the fun part of the film, and the analysis is the work that went into creating it. Hitchcock's movies are almost always densely and intensely plotted and constructed. He was a master planner. He was a pre-planner. He would get together with his screenwriter, his cinematographer, his editor, and they would map out the entire film over a series of weeks in pre-production, often with very, very detailed storyboards. There's very little sense of improvisation or happy accident in his films, and this one included. His films are really meticulously planned out in great detail before a single foot of film is even shot. He once said that the planning stage was the most exciting for him. The film had already been created, and shooting it was just a matter of working out the technical details. He began his film career as a title card designer for silent films in London and a storyboarder. And that attention to detail really shows up in most of his films, including this one, or maybe even particularly this one, because it moves rather subtly, almost imperceptibly, from a rather improbable comedy to a very dark and death-defying thriller. And this movie kind of stretches our suspension of disbelief into a full-blown muscle spasm, to be honest. The only reason this movie is allowed to play out is if we somehow fear that all of this could actually happen. And the other, you know, reason, other than all the contributors, which we'll talk about, of course, is the charm of Cary Grant. This movie probably could not have been made without Cary Grant's particular brand of debonair amusement. So I mentioned the storyboard. So I'm gonna switch now to a PowerPoint and I'll show you a bunch of things for a few minutes while I talk. And at some point, of course, I will stop talking, although it may seem like I'm not going to, and we'll share some of our best moments with this film. Okay, so here we go. There, can somebody give me a thumbs up? I just wanna make sure you can see. Yes, great, good, excellent. So, interestingly enough, because Hitchcock storyboarded his films with so much detail, a number of the storyboards from his films are often easy to find online. Here's one, it's probably the most famous scene in the film. It's Cary Grant alone in a cornfield. And this is one of a set of storyboards for that particular scene, which is a 10-minute scene that has only one line of dialogue, and it's a classic line of dialogue that you'll hear about later. This set of storyboards was sold at an auction after Hitchcock's death for about $5,000. Here's another storyboard, a little sepia toned, which is probably the second most famous scene in the movie, which is Cary Grant and Eva Marie Saint climbing down Mount Rushmore, which is probably the apex of improbability in this movie. And she does it, by the way, with gloves, heels, and a pocketbook. You know, that's poise. What can I say? It's also movie making. You just have to go along with it or the movie doesn't work. And then this is one that he worked out with his cinematographer. I think it's the cornfield scene because you can see a little sort of drawing of an airplane over there. But these are all different angles and movements, and you can get a sense of how intricately evolved this scene is. And then I found this one, which I really love because it's a side-by-side analysis of frames from the film in the center and the storyboards on either side. So before we go too much further, I'm going to swap out the PowerPoint for just a second. Sorry about that. That has been a little jarring. And I want to share just a brief film clip that'll give us a sense of who we're talking about. Many of you may already know this. Alfred Hitchcock is probably the only director who has his own instantly recognizable theme music, his own caricature, which is self-drawn, and his own nickname, which he gave himself, the Master of Suspense. So I'm going to play for you just a little visual, oral tidbit from his very sardonic sense of humor. Okay, whoops, nope, sorry. I have to go back for 1 second. I told you that would happen. There we go. Okay, now we can do it. So here's something to get you in the mood.
Good evening.
So that was that was the beginning of every Alfred Hitchcock television show. And as a child, that music and that image kind of terrified me a bit. And I think you're supposed to be. He was a rather sardonic man who had a very kind of, not vicious, but morbid sense of humor. That piece of music is a funeral march that was written for a marionette funeral by Gounod, who also wrote Faust. It was rearranged by Bernard Herrmann to include a wide range of instruments and to be particularly ghoulish, a personality dimension that Alfred Hitchcock actually encouraged. I mentioned his sardonic sense of humor. He loved to play practical jokes on people that I don't know if they thought were funny. One night he bet his cameraman, not his cinematographer, but the cameraman, the camera operator, that he couldn't spend one whole night in the studio alone, chained to his camera and tripod. And of course the cameraman said, yeah, of course I can. I could do that easily. And so that was the bet. And Alfred Hitchcock only gave him, the only thing he had was a flagon of brandy, which was laced with a powerful emetic. I have to think that poor cameraman had a really miserable 12 hours. Hitchcock also invited people for a dinner party one night, and all the food, everything from soup to nuts to dessert, was blue. So that was the kind of twisted, sardonic sense. And I think, frankly, it comes from an episode from his childhood. At least he used to say that the episode that informed his character was that when he was 5 years old, his father, who was a greengrocer, Alfred had misbehaved, and his father gave him a note, a piece of paper folded up, and told him to bring it to the police station down the street, which Alfred did without ever opening the note. When he got there, he handed it to the desk sergeant, who looked at it, and on it, it said, "My son has been a bad boy. Please lock him up." And he was ushered into a cell for about 20 minutes. And he said that gave him a lifelong fear of authority and the police, and was responsible for his sort of sense of humor. So I'm going to return to the PowerPoint for just a few moments. There we go. Okay, so good evening, of course, was his standard greeting to everyone. So a little more about Alfred Hitchcock. He was born in 1899 in London, died in 1980. He was born August 13th, for those of you out there who are Leos. He entered silent films as a title card designer and as a sketch artist, also working on storyboards. He met a woman named Alma Revile, who you see here on the left. There's two pictures of them, one at their wedding and one working. And he was so shy, he could barely ask her out for a date. So after they knew each other, well, she proposed to him and they were married for, I don't know, decades and decades. He made 52 films that started in London in the silent era and ended in Hollywood. His first film was one called Number 13, which is lost. There are a few scraps of it left, and this is a still from it. The Manx Man was his last silent film in 29. His favorite silent film of his was The Lodger, you see here, because he said it was it told the story completely pictorially. There were very, very few title cards. Blackmail was his first sound film, and his last film, number 52, was Family Plot, which is a kind of goofy, silly thriller about a fake medium who actually stumbles onto something real by accident. North by Northwest was number 45 in the lineup. And what's really interesting about it is it's many things. It's his second longest film. It's 2 hours and 16 minutes. And the longest film, the only one that exceeds it, is his 1967 movie Topaz, which is 2 hours and 23 minutes. What I really find interesting about North by Northwest is it comes in the middle of his 1950s sort of critical French semiotic Freudian psychoanalytic period. If you look at the movies he made before it and after it, they're very dark. They're really about troubled people. Vertigo is about a man obsessed with a murdered woman or a woman who thinks she's reincarnated. Psycho, of course, is about a serial killer. Marnie is about a woman who is traumatized by a childhood incident. So a lot of these movies are about people who are deeply troubled. And the French semiotic critics had a field day with this. North by Northwest is a complete exception to that. I mean, I suppose there are some Freudian jokes throughout it, but on the whole, it's really a sort of light confection with some murderous undertones. But I think it's impossible to talk about this movie without talking about CGI, which is not computer generated imagery, but Cary Grant's image. It's just, he's really the center of the film. He gives the film its luster, but it's why we engage with the movie. And Hitchcock is very famous for saying, one, I'm going to try not to imitate him because that's going to sound weird, but it's almost unavoidable. One doesn't direct Cary Grant. One simply points the camera at him. And it was working with Cary Grant that inspired another famous quote of Hitchcock. Oh, before I get to that, they worked together on four films. The first one was the 1941 Suspicion, where he plays a possible bad guy, but Cary Grant and the studio changed the ending of the film. In the original script, he was the bad guy, but again, Cary Grant can't be the bad guy who was responsible for murdering an innocent young woman, so they changed the end. Probably one of my favorites of his is 1946 Notorious. He's paired with Ingrid Bergman, and just, it doesn't get better than that. To Catch a Thief was another very, very beautiful sort of light comedy with dark undertones with Hitchcock's favorite leading lady, Grace Kelly. And then came North by Northwest in 1959. And it was, it was working with Cary Grant that inspired another very famous quote of Hitchcock's, which is, most films try to be a slice of life. Mine are a slice of cake. And I think that fits with this movie. So the cast is, you know, I'm gonna review quickly before I turn the evening over to everyone. Just a few of the contributors to the film that made it as wonderful as it is. So certainly the cast. Jesse Weiss Landis was the perfect amused mother who's always shaking her head at her son. Interesting side note, Jesse Weiss Landis is only 7 years older than Cary Grant. So unless she had him when she was not even in puberty, It's kind of a miracle birth. James Mason is the perfect villain. And if you watch this movie enough times, you notice his facial expression almost never changes. He's this blank, morbid slate of sort of unknown evil. We know he's involved in something bad that involves smuggling secrets out of the US. What could be worse? Marvin Landau plays the perfect henchman. And there were a few lines in the script that indicated he was sort of romantically obsessed with James Mason, but they took those out. Hitchcock found him. He was playing Cassius in a production of Julius Caesar, which is absolute perfect casting. I've never seen anyone with a more lean and hungry look. And then, of course, there was Leo G. Carroll, who was the perfect government agent and probably one of Hitchcock's most famous actors, as you'll hear in a moment. And then, of course, there's the leading lady. Ah, but wait a minute. What's wrong with this picture? Some of you who love musicals may notice that this is not Eva Marie Saint, but it's Sid Charisse, who played femme fatales in a lot of musical movies in specialty numbers. Here she is blowing smoke out of her nose in Singing in the Rain. MGM, and this is the only film Hitchcock made for MGM. MGM was adamant that Sid Charisse play the femme fatale. And luckily for Hitch, he had a very smart and powerful agent who got him casting and script approval. And Hitch said, absolutely not. There's no way I'm casting her. To be honest, I love Sid Charisse. She's a fabulous dancer, not such a good actress. If you see any of the movies where she's got lines of dialogue, she's pretty wooden, but she looks great. So he had settled instead on the perfect double agent, Eva Marie Saint. I mean, her performance is just smooth as silk. And she's got those beautiful cheekbones and those bright eyes and that wry smile. And what's really interesting is how she got cast in that part. When she went to the audition, her mother said, you should pull your hair back, wear white gloves and a beige suit. That's what Hitchcock likes. And so she did that and she got the part. That's kind of a little bit of Eva Marie Saint lore. Early in the film, like day three, she really wasn't certain how Hitchcock wanted her to play the part. So she asked him, give me some direction. Tell me exactly what you want and I'll give it to you. I'm a theater trained actress. He told her three things that she says was the best direction she ever received. The first was lower your voice, not the volume, but just the timbre. Just let the words come out like honey. The second is don't use your hands, keep your body still. And the third, which was the best, was always make eye contact directly with Cary Grant. And I guess when you do that, your eyes look like this. So there she is in a couple of moments, including, and you'll hear a little bit more about this, one of the most alluring dresses I think I've ever seen in a film. It's got that very demure boat neck in front, and then this very seductive plunging neckline in the back. Well, I guess it's not a neckline, but there she is. Two sort of funny gaffes that got away from Hitchcock's control freak mechanism that involved both of them involving Eva Marie Saint. One of them is it goes by so fast you barely notice. I put a little red arrow here so you can see this little boy in the back. This is the scene where she has to shoot Cary Grant because she needs the bad guys to think she's with them, not with him, and the gun actually has blanks. I told you there'd be some spoilers. Well, the first couple of takes, the gun just didn't make a very loud noise. And although Hitch was assured they could add the sound in the editing, he wanted a big explosion. He just wanted it to sound real. So they got a gun that had a different charge, a different report, and it was loud. And somewhere on take three or four, this little boy sort of telegraphs it's going to happen because all of a sudden, he puts his fingers in his ears and hunches over because he knows the blast is going to be a little loud. Now, the reason this goes by is, first of all, he's in the background and he's not the focus of the scene, but you've got Eva Marie Saint drawing a gun and Cary Grant. This really, you're not going to be looking at anything else. The other thing is early in the train scene when she's trying to seduce him so that he can avoid being captured by the police who are looking for him. The line of dialogue that she actually says is, I never make love on an empty stomach, and the censors wouldn't allow that. So she still says that line, but they overdub it with, I never discuss making love on an empty stomach. But if you ever watch it with the sound off, she clearly says, I never make love. So a few other people in the movie, Doreen Lang, probably not a name anyone knows, but maybe a face you know. She has a short couple of scenes in the beginning as his sort of put upon secretary who knows what he needs and wants. She shows up a few years later in The Birds as the crazy mother who's freaked out by Tippi Hedren. And in this moment is when she's calling her out and saying, you're evil, evil. She's about to get her face slapped. Hitch was loyal to his extras. So here's a pop quiz. What actor has appeared in the most Hitchcock films? And the answer to that really depends on your definition of an actor. If you're talking about established actors who show up in the credits, it's Leo G. Carroll, who's Hitch's most credited actor. They worked on 6 films together, which you see here, Strangers on a Train, Spellbound, Suspicion, Rebecca, Paradine Case, North by Northwest. And in every one of those, he's always a professional. He's a doctor, a lawyer, some profound voice of morality that gets consulted somewhere in the movie. But there's somebody in Hitchcock's movies who far exceeds that, which is Bess Flowers, another name nobody knows. Bess Flowers might be in the Guinness Book of Records for being in the most movies ever. She was an extra. She got a few lines occasionally here and there. She was in over 1,000 films and 8 of them uncredited with Alfred Hitchcock. And in North by Northwest, she can be seen briefly in the hotel lounge as a patron. And she was in these films. But the actor that appears in the most Hitchcock films is, of course, the man himself. Alfred Hitchcock is famous for having a cameo in almost all of his movies, not some of the early silent ones, but starting in about 1928 or 29, is his little sort of wink to the audience. And here you can see some of the more fun appearances. This one's cool because in Stage Fright, Jane Wyman is walking down the street talking to herself and he turns and looks at her. Some of them are a little challenging. There are some where he can't possibly be present, like the movie Lifeboat. There's only 6 or 7 or 8 characters and they're all in the lifeboat. But in one scene, he's in an ad here for diet pills. He's both the before and after. In Family Plot, he's seen in silhouette talking to someone. This is his last appearance in his last film. And in Dilemma for Murder, which has really only 4 or 5 characters in the whole movie, he's seen in a photo at a class reunion. That's him there looking at the camera. He always said, I like to put myself early in the film so that the audience doesn't spend the whole time looking for him. He's sort of a one man Where's Waldo kind of thing. And in North by Northwest, he gets that done right out of the way, right underneath his credits. Under his own name, he runs for the bus that he misses and it takes off and he stands there. Early in the film, when the film started to be a big hit, he suggested this as a poster. And I'm hoping you can see the visual joke here. He's included himself in Mount Rushmore. And the people at MGM who didn't have the same sense of humor said, absolutely not. But they did use the poster about 4 years later when the movie was re-released and Hitchcock's name, just before Psycho, and Hitchcock's name was a big draw. So they agreed to this sort of insult to the founding fathers of the American presidency. And his appearance in his movies was so widely known that Mad Magazine did a parody. I'm sorry that this is so blurry. You can't quite see it. But he is in every panel. Here he's got a dagger through his head on television. Here he's peeping out from behind a lamppost. Here he's the sanitation worker. And just kind of fun. So I want to quickly introduce the team because although I could talk about this movie for hours, I want to leave a lot of time for just, well, not exactly Q&A, because I don't know that I can answer questions about the movie, but for discussion about how much we love it or where we don't love it, where we find it problematic. I can't proceed without giving some great credit to Ernest Lehman, the screenwriter, who I said wanted to write the Hitchcock picture to end all Hitchcock pictures and had the discussion about let's put all these scenes together. And what you get, oh, this is a little snapshot of his career. Ernest Lehman must be the most financially successful screenwriter in history. Every movie he made was a huge hit. Many of them won Oscars. He produced some of them. And it's a really wide range. I mean, everything from Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf to The Sound of Music, from West Side Story to Hello, Dolly. It's just it's a really expansive set of credentials. So consequently, the movie that he and Hitchcock developed is very picaresque. It takes place all over the map of the United States. It had seven major locations and several smaller ones, from the Plaza Hotel to the house on Long Island, to the library, to the UN public space, to on the train to Chicago, the scene in the auction where he's got to get arrested so he doesn't get killed. Of course, the cornfield, the house in South Dakota, Mount Rushmore. And it really captured one of Hitchcock's favorite themes, which is an innocent man trekking across a terrain. Sometimes it's Scotland, sometimes it's US, sometimes it's Morocco. Movies like The 39 Steps, Saboteur, Young and Innocent, Frenzy. These are all scenes in which, all movies in which an innocent man is sent across a landscape, trying to stay one step ahead of the police while trying to prove his innocence. In this case, however, it's not even innocence that Cary Grant is trying to prove, it's his identity. And so let's talk about that before I sort of take a break from my PowerPoint. In every Hitchcock movie, there's something called the MacGuffin. And that's a term some of you may know, some of you may not. So what is a MacGuffin? A MacGuffin is this thing that Alfred Hitchcock may have actually invented. I'm not clear on that, but he said it's a thing that the characters in the movie care deeply and passionately about. It's important to them, but it doesn't really matter to the audience. And it comes from an anecdote that he told many times on talk shows. He said, there are two men on a train heading up to Scotland, to the Scottish Highlands. And on the luggage rack above one of their heads is a big, odd package. And the other passenger says, what is that package above your head? And he said, oh, that's a MacGuffin. And the guy says, what's a MacGuffin? And he says, well, it's an instrument for trapping lions in the Scottish Highlands. And the other guy says, but there are no lions in the Scottish Highlands. And the first guy says, then that's no MacGuffin. So in this case, in this film, the MacGuffin is this fictional character that doesn't even exist called George Kaplan. George Kaplan is an identity made up by the CIA or the FBI or some American agency that they're using as a red herring to draw out these enemy agents from a foreign government. And what you see here in this moment is probably one of my two favorite moments in the movie. Roger O. Thornhill, the O is for nothing, played by Cary Grant, is having dinner with some clients. And he's about to raise his hand to signal to a bellboy that he needs a phone. And that simple act of raising his hand sets the whole plot in motion. It allows the spies to think that he is George Kaplan. And again, George Kaplan doesn't exist, but they spend the movie trying to kill him because they think he's George Kaplan. And he spends the movie trying to prove he's not George Kaplan, which according to them, he can't do. So the whole plot is set in motion by the simplest of gestures. It's less than 2 seconds on screen time. And it's the hinge moment. It's the moment that comes early in the movie, but it sets everything in motion. And so I think I'm gonna stop for a moment. I've got some more information. If we have time, I'll return to it. But it's all about how this movie got to be made. It's about Hitchcock's relationship with his cinematographer, with his editor, with other cast members, with the costumers. And because I just wanna give some, I wanna make sure we have time for just appreciative dialogue, I'm gonna stop sharing for now. And if we have time, I'll return to it. But I would like to open it up and just have people share what is their experience. I want to return to my first question, which is, what part of this film did you like the best, and what parts did you not like so much? And please remember, I'm not Alfred Hitchcock, so I can't necessarily answer questions. Kyle, I'm going to let you sort of play master of ceremonies. You'll be my George Kaplan if you don't mind.
Of course, of course. And I was just going to say, if you do want to say something or ask a question or just make a comment, you can use the raise hand feature, which someone has already. If you can't figure it out, you can also just raise your hand on camera and I'll look out for you. So it looks like we have Sandra.
Before,
What's up?
Before we start, I just want to send a shout out to someone who we're not seeing right now. Someone named Cynthia, who when their camera was on, had the most beautiful black cat in the background. I'm very partial to black cats. So shout out to your cat.
Okay. All right. So Sandra, feel free to make your comment, ask your question.
Sure. I was just going to say my favorite scene is the one that you're showing behind you, Alan. And the reason for that is I grew up not that far from where that supposedly took place. It's Route 41, which goes all the way up, really far up into Michigan and or Wisconsin, and all the way down to Florida. I grew up very close. I grew up in Gary, Indiana. And I think about that scene and what it looks like then and what it looks like today, which of course. So it's just fun when they call out the stops on the bus and the different towns that, you know, I lived by. It's just, it's my favorite.
Well, I'm so glad. Thank you for sharing that. I'm glad you gave us that first person perspective on that strip of, you know, barren cornfield and what it might be like now. But what I love about that scene, as I've already said, it's almost 10 minutes long and there's only one line of dialogue in it, which is, that's funny. That plane's dusting crops where there ain't no crops. And that tips off the Cary Grant character to the fact that something is very amiss. And Hitchcock loves setting dangerous scenes in the middle of daylight. He says, anybody, you know, the dark is scary, but let's do this in the middle of the day. And he does it in a completely open landscape where what could go wrong here? Well, what could go wrong is that's not really a crop duster. One funny thing is on day four, the movie had no costume costume designer, by the way. Alfred Hitchcock hated the designs that the MGM costumer gave. So he fired him and sent a costume coordinator to Bergdorf Goodman's to buy the clothes that you see. Cary Grant in this movie wears one outfit. He wears one suit. But somewhere around day three, they're shooting him running from the cornfields and he's wearing a freshly laundered suit. And the script supervisor said, we have to do today over. He's supposed to have crop dust all over him. And it's like, oops, that was an expensive mistake. They had to reshoot that whole day because he couldn't suddenly not have dust all over him. So thank you for starting with that scene. It's probably the iconic scene for this movie.
All right, Douglas.
I like the train scene. My wife and I took the Lakeshore Limited to Chicago, and that's definitely a drawing room. That's exactly how the Amtrak high-end rooms are laid out right now. But my question is about box office. Vertigo, which we recognize now as one of the greatest movies ever, was not so successful, dropped Jimmy Stewart, and this was a hit. And I don't understand. I don't think it even gets close to Vertigo. But if you could talk about the box office and why it was received so much more positively, that would be interesting.
You know, I can only guesstimate what the reaction is. I mean, Vertigo, although now generally considered one of Hitchcock's masterpieces, and he's got quite a few of them, you know, Rear Window, Psycho, quite a few. But it was not just dark, it was dark in a psychosexual way. And I just have a feeling audiences in 1954, unless you were a French semiotic film critic, I think audiences found it distasteful and confusing and troubling. Whereas this movie is really like, you know, whipped cream, you know, piled a little bit on top of some toxic substance. But this movie is really, it almost all of those set pieces, you know, from you know, the house, from the Plaza Hotel to the house on Long Island to the UN, all the way to Mount Rushmore, they gradually darken in tone and also in lighting. The movie ends at midnight. So there's it has an almost comic book quality. If you laid out the storyboards, it would probably read like a graphic novel. And I think people just found it more entertaining. It didn't ask them to think about deeply troubling psychopathia sexualis. And now, of course, we can deal with that. That's no biggie, no problem to us. But in 1956, 57, I think it made people uncomfortable. That's my best guess. What do you think? What does anyone else think?
I'm of the same opinion.
Yeah. Good. I mean, that's the only answer I can give you based on, you know, a little bit of very simple social psychology.
Okay. Beth, you're up.
So first of all, I just wanted to share something. Back in January, I took a trip down to Florida, and they had an incredible exhibit in the Boca Raton Museum, of all places, of Hollywood backdrops that were saved. And one of them was the Mount Rushmore scene, the actual backdrop from the Mount Rushmore scene from North by Northwest. So that was really incredible. The exhibit left in January. I was very fortunate to check it out. I don't know where it is now, but it was pretty amazing to see that firsthand. The movie itself, of course, like all of Hitchcock's films, you know, you were just so immersed in every scene, and it just leaves you on the edge of your seat. I personally love the scene where Eve Kendall is in the house, and Cary Grant's like trying to figure out how to get her out of there before she goes on that plane. And then, of course, I love that last scene where he's pulling her up, you know, on Mount Rushmore, and then it cuts to the two of them on the train. So that's got to be one of my favorite scenes. I love it.
Thank you so much for mentioning all of that, because it gives me a chance to introduce something I think is really important. Despite Hitchcock's meticulous planning, he had two very unpleasant surprises during the making of this film, both involving permission and rights. The first was at the UN. The UN absolutely forbid him to shoot not only inside the General Assembly, but even the grounds outside. It was considered a security risk. So all of the scenes, well, not all of the scenes, the scene inside, which is another favorite moment of me, when he's talking to the guy who owns that, Townsend, that's his name, who owns the house where he was, you know, almost killed the night before. And one of the spies throws a dagger across the anteroom and hits him square between the shoulder blades, killing him. And there's Cary Grant standing there with the knife in his hand, trying to say, "I had nothing to do with this." So, I mean, it's both horrifying and hilarious. But that entire scene, of course, was built in a studio because the UN wouldn't let him film. And my favorite single shot in this movie is the shot from way up above the UN when Cary Grant is running away from that scene because he doesn't want to be arrested for murder. And we see the empty forecourt with a single human being walking across the forecourt. That was not Cary Grant. That was a double, and it was shot surreptitiously. It was shot from high above, I guess, a helicopter. But the UN neither knew about it nor gave permission for it. And the same is true with Mount Rushmore. Mount Rushmore said, no way, this is a national monument. You can't come here and shoot a movie. So they recreated it on a matte projection that was huge. It was 35 feet high, which is about 3 stories tall, and over 150 feet wide. It was a complete sort of, you know, background cyclorama of Mount Rushmore, and all of the scenes of them, you know, clambering down it and slipping and falling and sliding were big, paper mache constructions, which is a good thing because there's no way they could ever actually film that on Mount Rushmore. Somebody would die, probably Eva Marie Saint. So thank you. And that moment where he tries to let her know he's in the house. Also, that house didn't exist. The house that we see from the exterior is a scale model. And of course the interiors are a set, but I love he throws the matchbook that says ROT as initials, and she picks it up and we don't even see her reaction. We just watch her shoulders tense up from behind. And It's perfect Hitchcock screen acting. We don't even see the actor's face.
Yeah, that's something I love about Hitchcock in general too, is like when he shows action happening from a distance, like whether it's in this film or it's in Rear Window, when we're literally watching like other people's rooms and apartments. I really love that.
And one last thing that you mentioned, that moment where she's just about to plunge down Mount Rushmore, and he's got her by the wrist and then pulls her up, and they're suddenly back in the train car, and we know that they're finally going to have their moment. That's almost the equivalent of saying, you know, that's all, folks. So there really is a kind of cartoonish, it's been all right, it's been a fun ride, folks. Have a good night.
Okay, Barbara, step right up.
Okay, so I was noticing in the auction scene something very interesting between Cary Grant and James Mason, that James Mason kind of really held his own in his sparring with Cary Grant in terms of charm, and you know, really seemed like he won in a way with the conversation. And I felt there was a subtext in it of a competition between the two actors, and it was kind of they're talking about acting, not just about what their roles were in the film, but about acting in general. And how, like James Mason, you know, said, oh, you play a lot of roles. I see you have your this, now you're this, now you're that. And they're both British actors. They're both around the same age. They probably, you know, maybe went for similar parts. And then when he tells Cary Grant, well, I think maybe you should have gone back for some training. Instead of going like to train at the FBI, you should have trained at the actor's studio, which I thought was hysterical.
It's delicious. And there are many references like that through the film about performance, because James Mason believes that Cary Grant is this person who doesn't exist and he's pretending not to be. There's also a fabulous contrast in their visual appearance. I mean, Cary Grant is just smooth and supple and beautiful. And James Mason is kind of craggy and not wrinkly exactly, but you know, deeply etched lines. And so they form an actual almost visual contrast. But there's also a not so subtle subplot about who is really with Eve Kendall, which is Eva Marie Saint's character's name. There's, you know, there's a little bit of tug of war about her as well. And when James Mason's character, Van Damme, suspects that Eve may have slept with Cary Grant, it's, you know, he's looking forward to the delight of killing him someday, but it can't be in that auction scene. That's a perfect acting exercise scene, because Cary Grant has to get out of the scene. Everything is keeping him in and he's got to get out. So he acts the complete fool and sort of throws the auctioneer way off balance. I love the fact that there's a woman who probably told this story at every dinner party she went to for years, where she gets to turn around to him and says, "You're an idiot." I mean, nobody got to say that to Cary Grant, so I'm sure she dined out on that quite a lot.
All right, Emily.
Before I go, I just wanted to say also that Marshall has had his hand up for a little bit, so I think he should go before me.
Oh, thank you for catching that, Marshall.
Thank you very much, Emily. I just wanted to add a bit of trivia. Did anybody notice at the 4-5 minute mark, when Cary Grant enters the hotel on the way to lunch, just before he's kidnapped, the music that's playing in the lobby as he walks through the lobby, it's very Hitchcockian, I think. They're playing "It's a Most Unusual Day."
Ah, okay.
And that's the sort of thing Hitchcock would do.
Yes, it is. Definitely a subtle, not so subtle joke to what is about to happen to Cary Grant. But I'm glad you mentioned the music, because the music, of course, was designed and composed by Bernard Herrmann, who worked with Hitchcock on, I forget how many films, 9 films, I think. including The Birds, which has no soundtrack. It's one of the only movies I can think of. There aren't many, but it has absolutely no soundtrack other than, you know, the menacing cawing and chattering of the birds. Bernard Herrmann was a consultant on that, a sound consultant. But their last film together was the 1963 or 64 film Torn Curtain with Paul Newman and Julie Andrews. And Alfred Hitchcock and Bernard Herrmann had a huge argument about the score for that movie. And not only did they never work again, I don't think they ever spoke to each other again after that. There was a real break. But his score for any score that Bernard Herrmann did was memorable. I mean, he just was really one of the most innovative film composers. But two of the scores he did for Hitchcock, Psycho and North by Northwest, I think are his most effective. They're absolutely jarring and unsettling and very disorienting. So and very effective and oddly melodic despite that. So thank you for mentioning that.
Thank you, Emily.
All right, Emily.
I just wanted to mention that to me, this is one of his scariest movies. I mean, it's not, I think even more so than something like The Birds or Psycho, and partially probably because I'm desensitized to those, especially with the way horror has played off of both of those movies now in, you know, modern cinema. But I think it's so much more frightening, this idea of no one believing you, not knowing who to trust, and just like being completely uprooted from your life and torn away from anything familiar or safe and not knowing where to turn. And it's just so absolutely terrifying to me. And I think part of it too is the kind of the visual, like visually it's not a dark movie. It's, you know, there's a lot of lightness in a lot of the scenes. There's, you know, not a lot of dark lighting or anything. And I think that makes it even scarier because it's normal. And, you know, like a horror movie, if it's at night, oh, of course that's scary. But a horror movie that's done in the day, that would be even scarier because you're taking the safe thing away from the audience. So I'm just curious if anybody else kind of feels that same way.
I hope they do, because that's a brilliant point. I wish I had thought to make it. It's really, yeah, that the highlighting and the initial comic tone of it is truly a smokescreen for this frightening experience of no one believing you are who you say you are and not knowing who to trust. You put it very beautifully. Thank you. So I saw somebody had their hand in response to that. Do you mind, Polly? Yes, Polly, thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Emily, I think that's a great point. I've always, in particular, found the last scene in that very modern house, which I'm always fascinated with, that, you know, you think it's perched on the top of Mount Rushmore somehow, and it's so isolated, and the plane and everything. I think that is so remarkably tense and truly frightening to me. I was actually going to make a different point, though, which is kind of going towards the back to the conversation about vertigo and sort of the you know, psychosexual underpinnings of a lot of his films at this point. And there's a little bit of that going on here, which I think is delightful and strange and weird. And I think that the actors had to have been aware of it, which is, in particular, I know we're needing to wrap up, but this very odd relationship that he has with his mother is just so bizarrely delightful. And there's obviously something going on, kind of bookends this sort of Martin, the guy, the actor at the end, and that sort of sexual underpinnings to his performance. But yeah, so I'll just stop with that and see what other people have to say about that.
I'm very glad you mentioned it, because I don't know anything about Alfred Hitchcock's mother, but he certainly had a very skewed vision of motherhood. They occupy a very strange and special place in his landscape. What's wonderful about Jesse Rice Landis, who only has a few scenes, is that she really does convey this kind of amused, you know, oh, Roger, you've done it again. But she, with so much kind of, not just dignity, but just her class almost matches Cary Grant's. You can believe that she's his bridge-playing, theater-going mother.
Looks like Beth has their hand up again, or is that from last time?
No, I was just going to add something if anyone else wants to go ahead of me. I was thinking about, it's funny you mentioned Notorious, and I was just going to mention some of the parallels with, you know, the Ingrid Bergman character, who I can't think of the top of my head, and the Eve Kendall.
Alicia Huberman.
Thank you, because that movie also is unbelievable. The parallels with Elise and Eve Saint, you know, Eve Kendall, as far as their, you know, Cary Grant in both roles, talking about how distraught he is over the physical sacrifices that they're making,
you know,
as well. So I just, you know, just wanted to add that.
No, that's perfect. They're both double agents, and their work as sort of spies involves them sleeping with people for nefarious reasons. They have to sacrifice their, you know, I don't even know what word, sacrifice something, their body, to help the government. And it's not a sacrifice that men are asked to make in Hitchcock films.
And especially, just to add, especially during the times these films were made, you know, to bring up that particular topic for women to be doing this, you know.
Yeah. One of the wonderful things I love about Notorious, because she was so beautiful and pure and Nordic, I think Ingrid Bergman, who was an exceptional actress, often got cast as the noble woman, the good woman. I mean, she played, you know, Elsa in Casablanca and Joan of Arc. She didn't always get the chance to be someone wild and, you know, and sexual. And in Notorious, you know, she's a party girl. She's a playgirl. At one point, she refers to herself as a tramp, like anyone would ever call Ingrid Bergman that. But she doesn't always get the chance to play the wild woman. So it was and she does it better than anybody else could have.
I should add that the Senate, I believe it was the Senate, if not the House of the United States, denounced her for having children, twins out of wedlock.
Yes.
So somebody didn't like her.
She lost an American career between, 1948 to 56. She worked a lot in Europe for the man she went there to marry, did a lot of films in Europe. But her big comeback in 1956 was Anastasia, which was made in Europe and became a big hit. And I guess Hollywood loves to forgive people as much as they love to blame them. So she wasn't vilified for being a communist, but for being the wanton woman that they didn't want her to be. But you're absolutely right. We have time for maybe one half of a question more.
No one else has anything to say.
Well, in that case, let me send you out with one little bit of humor, if you don't mind. Just something I discovered by accident, and I think it's worth sharing as a final note.
Please do.
Yes, here we go. This illustrates the enduring popularity of Alfred Hitchcock. Whoops. Go.
Evening.
So I don't know, maybe that's the right note to end on.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Alan, for leading such like a great discussion and a great lecture. I loved it, and I can't wait to see what you do for Wizard of Oz.
Thank you. I hope I'm worthy.
You absolutely are.
You're very kind.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Have a great night. Thank you so much for joining us.